Supernovas are well-known explosions that mark the end of the life of some stars and seed the cosmos with heavy chemical elements. However, that's not what will happen to the Sun. There will be no big explosion. Today, we introduce the helium flash, a spectacular burst that will precede the death of our star, and paradoxically, we won't be able to see it. Well, assuming anyone is left to see it. What will the last days of the Sun be like? How will its death affect the Earth? How much time do we have left? Let's find out. Like all stars, the Sun produces the energy that keeps it stable through nuclear fusion in its core, where the temperature and pressure are sufficient. A chain of reactions transforms hydrogen into helium, but that hydrogen won't last forever. In about 5 billion years, it will be exhausted, and that will be the beginning of the end. Even before that, we will experience changes on Earth. As the Sun depletes its fuel, it becomes gradually brighter. Indeed, as there is less fuel, fusion slows down and produces less energy. Gravity momentarily takes over, and the core contracts, increasing its density and temperature. This accelerates fusion and restores equilibrium. But look, now more energy is being produced than before. This extra energy makes the star grow in brightness and size as the outer layers are pushed outward. This process doesn't happen overnight, of course. The Sun's luminosity increases by about 1% every 100 million years, nothing we will notice in our lifetimes. But in about a billion years, the Sun will become too bright. Initially, the Earth could naturally compensate for this increase in brightness by progressively reducing the greenhouse effect. More light would enter, yes, but with less capacity to absorb it, a life-compatible temperature could be maintained. In fact, our planet has likely been doing this since it formed and manages it thanks to rocks. Temperature increases the erosion of silicates on the Earth's surface, a process in which they absorb CO2 to form carbonates. The greenhouse gas gets trapped in the rock, and all is well. However, this has serious consequences. Within about 600 million years, the CO2 concentration will be 8 times lower than it is today, insufficient for plants to photosynthesize. Plants will die, oxygen will disappear from the atmosphere, and gradually all living beings will perish. Even if we develop technology to adapt, the temperature would rise to about 50 degrees Celsius, the oceans would begin to evaporate, and our planet would turn into a desert. Worse still, as water vapor increases in the stratosphere, ultraviolet radiation will break water molecules into hydrogen and oxygen. The lighter hydrogen will escape into space, leaving us without an essential element for life. But let's get back to the Sun. 5 billion years have passed, and the hydrogen in the core is almost gone. By then, the core will consist mainly of helium atoms, but won't be hot enough to fuse them, so it will no longer generate energy, and nothing will prevent it from collapsing under its own weight. At some point, a spherical shell around the core where there is still hydrogen will heat up enough to start fusing. Fusion is back, but a paradoxical situation arises. As the Sun's core collapses, the spherical shell generates more and more energy and pushes the outer layers outward. The Sun swells to approximately the orbit of Venus, now 150 times larger and over 1,000 times brighter than it is today. However, this energy spreads over an enormous surface, so it will be cooler. This will make the Sun change from yellow to a reddish-orange hue, becoming a red giant star. Too bad Earth will be uninhabitable by then, because it will be a grand spectacle, our star occupying more and more of the sky over about a billion years. But that phase also has an expiration date. As I said, the core continues to contract, but at some point, something stops its fall. Quantum mechanics. As the core's density increases, the electrons trapped inside are forced to occupy the same quantum state, like trying to sit in the same seat as someone else. This goes against the nature of electrons, forcing them to live on the edge, crammed into all the free quantum states without overlapping. A new state of matter has formed, degenerate gas. Like roommates finding increasingly inaccessible and convoluted places to sleep, electrons are forced to occupy higher and higher energy levels. This increasingly high price slows the core's collapse. At some point, about 10 billion years after exhausting its hydrogen, the core reaches 100 million degrees, a temperature sufficient for helium to start fusing into carbon and oxygen atoms. These reactions produce a lot of heat and have an astonishing effect on the degenerate core. You see, a degenerate gas behaves very differently from a normal one. In fact, it resembles a liquid more than a gas. In a normal gas, when the temperature rises, the pressure increases, causing the gas to expand and cool. But in a degenerate gas, pressure only depends on density. The only effect of a temperature increase is to accelerate nuclear reactions, which in turn raises the temperature, which accelerates the reactions. An uncontrolled reaction, a spectacle known as the helium flash, in a matter of minutes, it releases as much energy as the sun produces in tens or even hundreds of millions of years. For a brief moment, the core can become as luminous as all the stars in the Milky Way. However, this immense energy doesn't reach the star's surface. Most of it is invested in breaking the core's degeneracy, converting it into a normal gas that then expands enormously. So, someone looking at the sun probably wouldn't notice anything. But although it can't be seen from the outside, the helium flash has a very important effect. As the core expands, it cools, slowing nuclear reactions. Consequently, the outer layers contract, and the sun deflates to about 10 times its previous size. In reality, the helium flash has dealt a mortal blow to the sun. It has just over 100 million years of life left. The core continues to fuse helium more quietly, like returning to the peaceful life it had when burning hydrogen. Basically, the same steps repeat. First, the helium runs out and fusion stops in the carbon and oxygen core. It contracts and heats until the helium in a spherical shell starts fusing. The energy from this shell adds to that from the hydrogen shell, causing the sun to swell again, even more than the first time. This time, its outer layers may reach beyond Earth's orbit, and its luminosity may be more than 3,000 times greater than it is today. Does this mean the sun will engulf our planet? Let's see. Every time the sun swells, it grows so much that it can't hold its outer layers and loses some of its mass. As a result, its gravitational force weakens and Earth moves away. This could take us beyond Mars's orbit and save us from being charred. However, tidal forces between Earth and the sun's surface, similar to those creating ocean tides, could counteract this effect. It's not entirely clear what will happen to us. Now, the fact that there are two spherical shells where fusion occurs creates some complications. Helium runs out faster than hydrogen. So at some point, fusion in the helium shell stops, but the hydrogen shell quickly produces more helium, and this reignites, generating a thermal pulse, a burst much less powerful than the helium flash. The burst causes the star to expand and cool, momentarily halting fusion in the hydrogen shell, making the star contract. At some point, hydrogen fusion reactivates, and the cycle begins again. The sun may experience four or five of these bursts, about 100,000 years apart. The energy produced in each causes the sun to expel its outer layers into space, losing over 50% of its mass and creating a spherical gas shell around it. Meanwhile, the sun's core continues to collapse and heat. Although it never reaches the temperature for carbon to start fusing, it keeps contracting until it reaches roughly Earth's size. Then quantum mechanics stops the fall again due to the degeneracy of carbon's electrons. The core will now be around 100,000 degrees. Without its layers, exposed naked to space, we see it as white. The sun, or what's left of it, has become a white dwarf, a glowing ember that will slowly fade into a black dwarf over many billions of years. But there's more. At some point during the collapse, the sun starts emitting strong winds that shape the spherical shell into whimsical forms. The final result will be a vast cloud of ionized gas known as a planetary nebula, which will shine in bright colors in response to ultraviolet light from the white dwarf. For example, hydrogen emits red light, oxygen green light, and helium blue light. It will be a truly beautiful sight. So, what about us? Is there anything we can do to save ourselves? Although the sun won't engulf the Earth, it won't help much. By then, the habitable zone, where a planet can have liquid water on its surface, will have moved to the outer solar system. Perhaps some of the icy bodies in the Kuiper Belt could offer a temporary refuge, assuming they survived the chaotic death of the sun and remained bound to it. But once the sun dims and becomes a white dwarf, we will have lost our only natural source of light and heat, making life in the solar system impossible. Or will it? Some studies suggest that a planet close enough to a white dwarf could have the conditions necessary for life. So who knows? Humanity may not only witness the complex and spectacular death of the sun, but also survive it. Thanks for watching this video, and you know, if you want more science, just subscribe. Thanks for watching.